Thank you, Psychology Beyond Borders, for putting together this event and the other co-sponsors, Colombia and Psychiatric Institute, for helping to set up this wonderful opportunity. There will be a little bit of overlap between Dr. Silver, Chok, and myself, probably with kind of a little bit of different emphasis. I hope you wouldn't mind. This is my list of disclosures. And in my talk, I will touch upon the extraordinary magnitude of the September 11th attacks. I will talk a little bit about the mental health related goals of contemporary terrorism. I will touch upon the primary role that exposure to trauma plays in predicting post-disaster psychopathology. I will describe a little bit the broad range of mental health outcomes following disasters. We'll highlight the risk of different groups in the population, and we'll describe a bit processes of resilience and recovery. So the 9/11 attacks were the most damaging terrorist event occurred in this country and perhaps globally, with almost 3,000 fatalities, 14,000 evacuees from the World Trade Center towers, 80,000 jobs that lost after the attacks, with almost 90,000 people who were directly involved in the recovery and clinic efforts in the World Trade Center. So this was really a very, very dramatic and damaging event. And indeed, terrorist attacks, especially the successful act of terrorism, are intentionally traumatic attempts to aiming to erode security and safety in large populations. This is exactly their aim. And since 9/11, it seems that terrorism has become even more sophisticated, with frightening, frankly, capabilities to inflict enormous loss of life and damage on the general population. With a lot of support that terrorism can get inadvertently from wide media and web coverage, so dissemination of information about terrorist attacks is worldwide and immediate. Direct exposure remains the most powerful type of exposure to disaster, and study after study show that the mental health outcome of is directly related to the scope of the disaster, whether we are talking about loss of life, threat to life, injury, wide range witnessing, or we are talking about loss of property, loss of finance, or any other resources. And of course, post-disaster periods are always tough and painful, with ongoing adversities, lack of housing, displacement, being fired from a job, etc. Those factors, research is showing, may be involved both in the onset of the mental health outcomes, in the development of the outcomes, as well as in the persistence, in the enduring, in the trajectory of the mental health outcomes over time. Now, it is Especially important to note, and this is kind of my favorite, some of you that know me, that the impact of trauma is certainly wide and not limited to post-traumatic stress disorder. In other words, trauma exposure can lead to other anxiety disorders. I will talk about it later on, to depressive symptoms, substance abuse, alcohol abuse, physical illness, functional impairment, and of course, complicated grief among people who lost somebody due to the attacks. Yet, post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, is certainly the most documented and most researched, I would say, trauma outcome, with symptoms including reliving or re-experiencing, such as nightmares of the event, flashbacks around the event, avoidances, intentional avoidances of event reminders, people who avoid going, taking the subway to Ground Zero, or crossing the bridge, or taking a flight, or people avoiding looking at the news media, as well as heightened levels of arousal and vigilance, very, very common in PTSD patients, that all lead to a significant impairment in functioning. The duration of the symptoms should be at least 1 month to be qualified for the PTSD syndrome, and chronic PTSD, of course, is more enduring and can be prolonged at 3 months or more. Now, findings from 9/11 research about PTSD are kind of interesting and should be noted. You know, I recently looked at the overall literature conducted on PTSD following 9/11, and I noticed that in the general population, in the community, as Dr. Silver mentioned as well, overall, among indirectly exposed populations, the prevalent rate of PTSD went down significantly, almost diminished over time. This is good news. However, if we zoom in, you know, like good photographers, on specific populations with specific risks, such as first responders, journalists, evacuees, bereaved, or people with few resources, you know, the minority subgroups in the general population, especially Hispanics and African Americans, which have, you know, few resources to start with. In those specific groups, we can identify high rates of PTSD. So this is just an example study conducted by our colleague Sandro Galea and his colleagues in New York right after 9/11, 1, 4, and 6 months after 9/11. You can see rates of PTSD going down from 7.5% to less than 1% over the first 6 years after 9/11. However, if you look at studies that conducted among first responders, such as firefighters, you can see that over the first 4 years after the attack, rates are really remained more or less the same, around 10%, between 9.8 to 11.7% at year three. So rates are much higher and kind of stabilized, sometimes increased over time. If you look at other data from the World Trade Center, World Trade Registry, a study published in JAMA by Breckville and colleagues showing that among rescue and recovery workers, lower Manhattan residents and passerby rates of PTSD are actually going up, you know, over the 6 years after 9/11. So that's kind of interesting to digest and to understand. Now, major depression is very common among people exposed to 9/11 attacks or any other disaster. Depression characterized by ongoing low mood combined with low self-esteem and a loss of interest in normally enjoyable activities. 9/11 findings showing that depression is quite common and highly associated with loss of life, displacement, all of those interest kind of, specific types of trauma exposure that I described before, relocation, lack of social support, being alone, for example, found to be a powerful predictor of depression post 9/11, and it's showing up incredibly high in low-income ethnic population. This is data from an NIMH study I conducted in one and 4 years after 9/11 in primary care patients, primarily Hispanics, living in this area in Washington Heights, nearby our research center, showing that 1 year after 9/11, rates of depression were high as 33% of the sample we studied, almost a third of the sample as MDD among people who reported loss in 9/11. So if you knew somebody who died in 9/11 and this person was close to you, you are at elevated risk for PTSD right after 9/11 in the first year, as well as 4 years after 9/11, going down to only 27%. GAD, generalized anxiety disorder, you can say, how GAD is really related to terrorism. When you look at the symptoms of GAD, you can see a lot of meaning into that, with ongoing excessive, uncontrollable, and often irrational worry about everyday things that is disproportionate to the actual source of worry. People with GAD commonly think about disasters and death and health issues. Again, GAD found to be highly common among low-income minority populations, and especially among those who experienced loss in 9/11. This is the same cohort of primary care patients I described about. You can see elevated prevalence of GAD up to 22% after 9/11, going down to 14% 4 years after 9/11 among people who experienced loss. Complicated grief is very common among people who lost somebody in violence, especially from malicious acts of violence. That's why we thought at looking at a national sample of people who experienced 9/11 loss, and we found that 2 to 3 years after 9/11, four in every 10 bereaved found to have full-blown complicated grief, and almost 40% of the population. And importantly, complicated grief is very different from PTSD and depression, and really not addressed very well by, for example, medication that address depressive symptoms quite effectively, suggesting that people with complicated grief should receive very focused and bereavement-oriented treatment in order to recover. I'll try to rush a little bit over the high-risk groups, and certainly women, children, and to a certain extent older adults are certainly subgroups that deserve a lot of attention in the aftermath of disasters. Media personnel, especially reporters and photographers who are rushing to the site, are at higher risk for post-trauma psychopathology and should be aware to that. And first responders, as I said before, are at exceptional risk for not only PTSD, also substance abuse depression, and should be addressed over time. Yet, just to kind of starting summarizing, as Dr. Silver suggested before, and I completely in agreement, there is a remarkable remarkable demonstration of resilience, especially in the general population, And especially in New York City post 9/11, most people are either minimally affected and able to adapt to the disaster, or are able really to maintain, you know, stable and effective functioning during and after the exposure, which is really impressive and important to note. Recovery is also very frequent. We regularly see in the data how do we have kind of a spike of psychopathology in the initial phases, going down, almost diminishing over time. This is really a trajectory of recovery in which there is a significant elevation of stress-related symptoms, or I would say PTSD-like symptoms initially, which are kind of going down and expected to go down over time. And so recoverers are everywhere and should be recognized for what they experience. And this is why I'm very concerned many times about kind of stigmatizing population who have initial symptoms, and I kind of warn, you know, my colleagues and ourselves, you know, not to name them, you know, in jargon type of diagnosis too early. Conclusions. As I try to suggest, terrorism may have wide and enduring effects, especially in subgroups in the general population, those who are directly exposed, those responders, journalists, and other people bereaved, those may have ongoing and enduring risk for a range of psychopathology. As I said, mental health consequences of trauma are not limited to PTSD, although PTSD is the most notorious post-disaster syndrome and studied the most. And most people are quite resilient and expected to recover over time. Yet women, some elderly children, media personnel, as I said, and first responders deserve ongoing attention post-disaster. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Counterpoint to Roxy. Alexa from Brooklyn wonders if you or anyone has been studying the psychological impact of unsuccessful attacks. Now, what do we know about thwarted terrorism incidents that don't produce the full shock and horror of a 9/11 and yet contribute to a climate of fear and stress out there?
I can comment on that indirectly from my experience in Israel, the country where I grew up in. In that country, we have a phenomenon in which the population is has ongoing exposure to trauma over time, over many years. Different types of trauma could be terrorist attacks, could be military conflict, could be direct fire or indirect fire on certain portions of the population. You know, the overall impact of such ongoing exposure is certainly different from an exposure to a single, you know, large or shockingly large traumatic event as 9/11.
Thomas Fullerton, from Fullerton, California, wonders about research specifically on long-term anxiety or traumatic stressors in first responders. You began to address that, but maybe elaborate just a bit.
Well, there is hi, Thomas. There is a lot of data on first responders with certainly great information to the public. As I said, first responders are the subgroup that is have probably the highest risk for post disaster, both mental health problems and physical health problems. Yet even in this group, you know, the majority of this group is either resilient to start with or tend to recover from initial you know, elevation of symptoms. When I say, you know, the highest risk, for example, for PTSD over the, you know, during the 6 years after 9/11, data is showing that around 10%, perhaps a little bit more, of this subgroup in New York City-based firefighters are likely to endure full-blown PTSD. And full-blown PTSD, 6 years after exposure, is generally comorbid with other psychopathology, such as depression, other anxiety disorders, as well as a host of, you know, physical symptoms. Certainly, you know, a concerning piece of data that deserves a lot of attention from policymakers.
And Yuval, let me just close with one question of my own. And by the way, I was glad to hear you mention media workers, because certainly for journalists, not only rushing to the scene and covering the attacks, but the long months of recovery on the site were quite stressful. Let me ask you a question. I was struck, even though I've seen the data before, about the high rates of comorbid PTSD, depression, general anxiety, complicated grief. How do these, and after 9/11, what have you learned about how these pathologies play together? When they are all present at the same time, are we seeing something new and different and more complex, or are we, what are we seeing there?
So it's really about complexity. We see different types of disorders interacting with each other. Just for example, PTSD is known to be conceptualized as a fear-related disorder. Depression is a different type of disorder. The way they co-occurred or comorbid is a great scientific inquiry. It's not clear whether depression is coming after PTSD, what is really the interplay between the symptoms, whether both disorders share, you know, the same neurobiological basis. So there is a lot to learn, but complexity is really the name of the game.
Thank you. And again, here in the room, you probably, many of you have questions for Yuval Nuria. Hold on to them. We'll get to you after the formal webinar is